Hello, and welcome to our show today, ladies and gentlemen. We're very fortunate today to have Craig Strain with us. Craig is probably one of the best mover and shakers of music in the Detroit area that we've had. He is actually running two or three bands. He's got a great background in music. And welcome to our show, Craig.
Thank you very much, George. You know, it's a pleasure to be interviewed by someone who is a musician like you who knows what they're talking about when we talk about music.
Well, it's great to be here, I'll tell you. Let me just ask you a little bit about your background. I mean, you've been in music now for probably a few years, right?
A few years. I grew up in Garden City.
Okay.
And it was during the beginning of the teen clubs.
Okay.
Clubs that were like for teenagers, no alcohol, but food and drinks and dancing. And so teen club bands started up then. And
okay.
So when I was just barely 16, I was in a band that played at the various teen clubs in the area.
Okay.
That really was my start, at least performing.
And what kind of music did you play? Was it the
we
old played 50s
the
rock
50s
and roll?
Rock and roll.
There you go.
And the bands were usually rhythm section, singer, and a saxophone. There was only one band that had a trumpet in it. That was the one I was doing. But that was kind of my start performing professionally.
You know, I kind of started the same way. I had a little, we started a little band in high school.
Yeah.
And we had a trumpet and a saxophone and a piano and drums. And then all of a sudden it started to grow. Other kids wanted to get in the band.
Yes, yeah.
So it and we played for the teen dances like you did. But yeah. We were just prior to rock and roll.
Ah.
So we were playing the old standards, mostly the
sure,
old standards.
Yeah.
But that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
So you formed this teen band, you played around during high school.
Right.
And then I assume you started doing something after high school.
Well, I went to college. I went to Eastern Michigan University, and I majored in music and political science. I had a double major.
Oh.
I was always interested in politics growing up. My family was interested in that, and my sister and I both got involved learning about what was going on with the government and how
right.
it worked and everything.
Right, right.
And so I was at Eastern, and there was no jazz band. I said, how can there be no jazz band? So I started one.
Oh, great.
And there was enough interest. It wasn't for credit at first. It was just kind of like a non-college credit
right.
thing we did.
Right.
And from there.
Was it a full 18-piece band?
Yes.
Oh, great.
Yeah. At first, it was about 14, and then people heard about it, music majors and
right.
non-music majors. And so we started doing that. And then I started playing more gigs with
yeah.
with wedding type bands
right,
and tried
right,
to
right.
squeeze that in when I could, you know.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's the way I went through college, playing
yeah.
playing frat parties and
right.
you know, doing
right.
that type of thing. It was
yeah.
great.
Yeah.
But playing back then was a little different for me because we weren't into rock and roll yet. We were just kind of starting to get there.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Bill Haley and the Comets were just coming out.
Yeah.
And, you know, they made their big first hit with, I forgot what it was. But anyway, I did get a chance to go to see them, and I was blown away with the guy
yeah.
standing on his bass fiddle,
yeah.
playing it like he was playing a guitar. You
yeah,
know?
And we look back now, and we think rock and roll with an acoustic bass.
Yeah,
you
right.
know, with an upright double bass.
Yeah, exactly.
You know? So it's all different than it is now.
Yeah, and the guy was riding it like a horse. He was
yeah.
and playing the bass.
Yeah.
You know, it was basically a show band.
Exactly.
You know, they did a lot of
exactly.
a lot of show stuff.
Yeah.
But it was great.
And then when I graduated from Eastern, I was fortunate enough to be accepted into the U of M Law School, and so I went to law school for one semester.
Really?
I had just gotten married at the time, but it turned out not to be quite what I was hoping, and I missed the music. I remember in particular at U of M in a properties class, I'm sitting there listening to the lecture and I can hear the Michigan marching band off
oh my
in
God.
The distance, and I'm kind of analyzing the chords in my head. So I went back to Eastern and got my teaching certificate and my master's degree and started teaching at that time.
But and I assume you took some arranging courses at
you
that
know,
point?
You know, interestingly enough, I did not.
Really?
I had pretty much been writing, in a sense writing, from when I was about 16 years old.
Okay.
I was the one that was showing the saxophone player, no, your part is this, or whatever.
Oh, yeah,
you know?
Right.
It just came kind of easy for me.
Right.
And in fact, I thought everybody heard everything that I heard in the music. And then when I put a band together, I realized, no, the bass player is not playing what's on the 45.
Right,
you know?
Right,
and
right.
So I started teaching sort of,
okay.
because I could hear that stuff. And that led to writing, arranging. Mm-hmm. You know, in the first serious arranging, I think, was for the jazz band at Eastern when we didn't have charts. And some of the guys would say, oh, I can get this one, I can get this one. And I just started writing. And that was way before the computers.
Oh, yeah.
So you wrote
manual.
And then you wrote all the parts out.
Then you had to transpose everything into the right keys the horns and all that stuff. Right.
So, yes, I took theory classes and all that, but I really didn't take an arranging class. Okay. I kind of learned all that on my own and just kept writing.
I was fortunate enough to take an orchestration class
at
U of M Flint after I retired, after becoming like, you know, after being 60 years old. I went back to school with all the kids, you know.
Yeah.
And it was me, the old man in the class, and all these 18, 19-year-old kids.
Yeah.
And it was great going back. But and we had a jazz band at U of M Flint, and we had a jazz combo.
Okay,
and it was great fun.
Well, my first teaching job was at McKenzie High School in Detroit.
Okay,
and their program was pretty weak at that time, and I started writing Motown charts for the marching band.
And got their interest.
And way back then, a lot of marching bands weren't doing pop stuff or hip stuff. They were doing marches and that kind of stuff.
Right.
And so we started playing Motown stuff with the high school marching band, and that drew more kids into the program.
Oh, yeah.
And it grew pretty quickly.
Well, you know what people want to hear, right? They want to hear the current stuff. And, and like you say, Motown and a marching band.
Yeah.
And you get the kids to go out and do some of these fancy steps. I imagine they did some of that too, right?
Yep. Yep.
So That would have been great. So a marching band, and how many years did you spend teaching in high school?
30.
30 years?
Yeah, 30 years, and retired from that. And then I was able to spend more time developing my own groups and writing for other groups at the same time.
But during those 30 years, you must have probably had some decent bands.
Yes.
You know?
The last school I was at was Novi. And, they were one of the weakest in the state, and it took about 5 or 6 years, and then we started getting straight ones at the festival.
Oh,
and
really?
We played the several events, the yearly, forgotten the name now, but we played in Hill Auditorium. And
oh, really?
And, the bands became quite top-notch.
That's great.
Yeah.
So it must be a good feeling to take a group of kids that, you know, from scratch, basically, who aren't playing very well and develop that band into something that's really good.
Yeah. The term I was trying to think of, the Midwest Conference, used to be in Ann Arbor. It's not anymore. But in one day, the symphony band played in Hill Auditorium as a featured band. Then the band ran over to another building, and we were the sight reading example as the best sight reading band of the year.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's fantastic.
And then we ran over to another building, and the jazz band played all in one day.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You're running your tail off that day.
Yeah.
And the kids are probably enjoying it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. High school kids, you know, Lake Orion has a terrific program.
Mm-hmm.
And they're getting ones, you know, doing.
Right.
And they're marching, their football shows, fantastic.
Yeah.
I think they came in, a couple of years ago, they came in second in the state.
Nice,
which is, you know, great.
And in the meantime, I taught, after I retired, I taught at Macomb Community College. I taught a jazz band and an improv class. And I taught a Blue Lake Fine Arts camp. And
I just got back from there.
Yeah, I saw your pictures. That's great.
Just got back from there. Blue Lake, I think they're going to start a jazz band program next year.
Oh, good.
They've had one in the past. I can't remember the guy's name. George, somebody who played trombone with the Kay Winding group years ago.
Okay.
And led the jazz band, and it had a terrific jazz band out there. They call it the Blue Lake Monster Band.
Okay.
And Scott Gwinnell was in that band.
Oh, all right.
And so now you've gone through high school, you've done your thing, but as you're going through high school, I assume you're running professional bands as well?
Well, professional in the sense of playing the teen clubs like we talked about in high school. So, yeah, we got paid. Yeah.
Right.
And,
right.
And then I played not so much in college, but a little bit here and there in terms of performances at gigs.
Yeah, but how about during the time you were teaching high school? Did you do a lot of professional stuff back then, or was it mostly concentrating on high school?
Well, it was both. I have that A personality that,
okay,
you know, yeah. And I was playing in a, we used to call them wedding bands or private
right.
event bands, and
yep.
and I was doing those. But I was also, I remember playing once in a while in different clubs in different places
right.
too at the same time. Yeah, I kept, so I continued that all the way through.
Okay. So now you're finished your 30-year career, and now you got time to really focus on music, right?
That's true.
The professional type of music.
Right. I was leading the Brookside Jazz Ensemble while I was still teaching.
Okay.
So those were overlapping. We rehearsed every Monday night at Cranbrook. In fact, that's where the name Brookside comes from, because we rehearsed at Brookside Elementary School.
Okay.
So it kind of sounded fancy, like, well, they must have been by a brook or something, you know.
Right, right.
Artistic. No, we rehearsed at the Brookside Elementary School.
Okay.
So that, and we had an opportunity there to rehearse for free in a fairly
nice,
big enough room.
Yeah.
And Kurt Newman and I ran that band together.
That's.
He did most of the business stuff, and I did most of the music stuff.
Oh, that's great.
That was a wonderful band, too.
That was back in the 70s, right?
Yes, in the 70s and early 80s. Ursula sang with us.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I moved to the Detroit area from Connecticut in 76.
Okay.
And I remember that band.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if I ever saw it live, but I remember hearing about it and saying to myself, boy, I'd really like to play in that band.
You know? Yeah, yeah.
But I did get to play with the Dick Murphy band out of
sure.
Pontiac.
Yeah.
I don't know if you knew Dick.
I didn't hear him, but I knew of that band.
It was a good band.
Yeah.
And I had an opportunity to play in the sax section of that.
That's terrific.
So that was kind of
yeah.
cool. But so now you're retired from schoolwork, right? And
yeah.
now you're starting to really get into this other kinds of music. Talk to me about this brass band that you started.
Well, I didn't exactly start it. John Aaron, who is heavy into that, was an officer in the Salvation Army, and he played in several brass bands, in particular in Chicago. He was in one of the best ones, and he moved. The officers get moved around with the Salvation
okay.
Army.
Yeah,
it's kind of like being in the Army.
Yeah, okay.
And he moved to Detroit, and he said, "Well, there's no brass band here. I'll start one." So
okay.
About the second rehearsal, Ray Murphy, whose kids I taught at Novi and was involved with the school board, he called me and he said, and he had this. Boston accent.
Okay.
He said, we're starting up this brass thing. I don't know exactly what it is, but why don't you come to a Monday rehearsal and see what it's all about? Well, he didn't say they're looking for a conductor. He just said that. And coincidentally, it was right about when Brookside was ending and they were rehearsing on Monday nights.
Okay.
And I thought, well, let's check it out. They're rehearsing at a Salvation Army facility in Plymouth, not far from my house.
Right.
And so I went. And I was sitting there listening to the rehearsal. I met John, who founded the band, and he was directing. He was a much better horn player than director. And he said, come up and do a couple tunes. Well, when I got in front of the band, I thought I could just wave the baton and go sit down, or I can correct some things.
Right.
And
right.
I couldn't help it, but correct
of course.
Some things. And by the end of the night, he asked me if I would become the conductor.
Okay.
And we became great friends. In the mm-hmm. first 4 or 5 years of the group, we grew members in quality, and he and I worked hand in hand. He's a wonderful musician mm-hmm. and a great guy, and we just met, you know. We just
it worked.
Joined, yeah, it worked, and that was the start. And I was there with the group for 25 years, and we grew and got better and better, and eventually became actually known throughout the country as one of the better brass bands.
Really?
So, yeah.
You know, we've got a couple of clips we want to take a look at.
Excellent.
Let's take a break and take a look.
Sounds good. Thank you.
okay, we're back. And boy, that was fantastic. Well, I love that band.
Thank you.
Especially that Birdland thing.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah.
that was great. So you also have a couple of other bands that you started, like the CSO, the Craig Strain Orchestra.
Right. I wrote some big band. I was writing for different groups, and I wrote some arrangements for a band on the east side. And she asked me to come and listen to a rehearsal, and my tunes in particular, and make some comments.
Right.
And so I did, and it didn't go really well. And when I got home, I was telling some of my friends that I wrote these charts and I really would like to hear them played really well. And somebody said, you know more musicians in town than anybody. Just call up a bunch of people, bring
right.
them over, and we'll read through the charts, you know?
Yeah.
And so we did.
See what it really should sound like, right?
Yeah. And by the end of that evening, they said, let's keep doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the start of CSO.
And how long ago was that?
About 10 years.
So it's been
12
going for
years,
about 10
something
years.
Like that. Yeah. Yeah. And little by little, I was determined to make it not like Brookside just because I didn't want to reinvent Brookside.
Right.
So I tried not to do the same charts and not to have the same people.
Mm-hmm.
And that worked out pretty well. And it gave me an opportunity to write a lot. And I was buying charts too, you know,
right.
doing both.
Right.
And pretty soon it just got better and better. And that's kind of the beginning of CSO.
That's a great band. I'll tell you, I've seen that band several times. And matter of fact, I've got some clips of that band as well.
Great.
I was at O'Malley's and heard that band a couple of times.
Yeah.
You got some great singers, by the way.
Oh, yeah. I've had different singers over the years.
Yeah.
And in
this case, it was Emma that was, what's her last name, Emma?
Emma Abu Qasim.
That's why I don't know the last name.
Yeah.
Abu Qasim.
But
she is a terrific singer.
Oh, gosh, yes. Yeah.
And she's
easy
great.
To work with.
Is she?
Oh, yeah.
Great.
I made up my mind about 10 years ago. There's so many great musicians in this town, in this area. There's no point working with people who have an attitude.
You're
it's
right.
It's not worth it.
You're
you know?
Absolutely
I don't
right.
care how good they are.
Yeah.
And I've proven that a couple of times. So, yeah. So, Emma. Singing with the band at O'Malley's. We're all crowded. It's
yeah.
a small place,
yeah,
but
yeah.
that was a lot of fun.
But it sounds great. Why don't we listen to, you know, she's singing one of your arrangements.
Oh, right.
Honeysuckle Rose.
Right, yeah. I heard her sing it one time with a small group, and I just had a different concept, but I told her, can we do this really, really fast? I'm going to write something that's very, very fast. And she said, absolutely. So it is very fast.
Yeah, it is. The tempo is right up there.
Yeah.
So why don't we listen to a little bit of Emma and doing her doing one of your arrangements?
Yes. Honeysuckle Rose. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. That band kicks butt, man.
Yeah, they
it's
sure
great.
Do. Yeah, a lot of fun. And you know, there's not much more pleasant, more pleasing than to write something. Have it in your head, have the concept, put it down in the computer, hope it'll sound like you think it might.
Right.
And then you have a great band like that play it. It's just like you created something, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's a wonderful feeling.
That's great. Now you one of the things you've done, especially recently, is you've done some arrangements for symphony orchestras.
Yes. I have an arrangement that the Phoenix Symphony performs.
Really?
And just recently, a percussionist, Pat Fisher, who plays with Motor City Brass Band, asked me to write an orchestral version of Motown Medley.
Okay.
Motown Medley originally was titled Motown Medley Plus One, because when I wrote it, I didn't realize the last piece wasn't Motown. So that became kind of a joke when it was introduced.
Right.
But then when I wrote it for the orchestra, Symphony Orchestra, I changed the last piece.
So did you?
Yeah, so okay. It was all Motown. And then she asked the conductor of the Rochester Symphony if they would perform it, and he looked at the score and he said, sure, absolutely. And my friend Keith and I went to the concert, outdoor concert. They have a beautiful facility and a huge hill. There must have been 2,000-3,000 people up there.
Wow.
And they performed it, and it was pretty exciting to hear that piece played by that wonderful orchestra. And then the conductor, when I went up and talked to him on the intermission, he said, this arrangement is brilliant.
And is that right?
I thought, thank
that
you.
That made you feel good,
thank
doesn't
you.
It?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it must feel really good to have that quality of group play arrangements.
Absolutely.
So it means the arrangements have to be good, or they wouldn't touch it, right?
Yeah, yeah. So I think when the Count Basie band came to Detroit to perform at Wayne State as a fundraiser, and the singer at the time, Dennis Rowland, who took over for Joe Williams.
Oh man.
Dennis had me write several things for him, not necessarily for Basie, but also for orchestras, and he traveled in Europe and did all this well.
Right.
He called me one day and he said, the Basie band's coming to do a fundraiser at Wayne State and we're gonna do one of your arrangements. And so I was there. I went and he sang it, and I was
fantastic.
In the audience, and they got all done, and then Dennis said, and the arranger's right here in the audience, Craig Strain, you know. And I said, Count Basie band played my tune. That's wonderful.
Wow, fantastic. Yeah. You know, Joe Williams brings up a great story. I used to live in Vermont. I'm born and brought up in Vermont. And
okay.
We used to always, every summer, the big bands would come through. And
sure.
We'd always go to this one roller skating rink, and all the big bands would come. Basie band would come through. The Woody Herman band, they all came through. And so I'm sitting there in my 1950 Ford having a little drink before we go into the concert.
Uh-huh.
And I said, you know, I got to make a phone call. So I walk over to this phone booth, and guess who's in the phone booth? Joe Williams.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. Wow.
And I got another story. I got a quick story to tell you about Dizzy Gillespie. We're going to a concert in Burlington, Vermont, at the Memorial Auditorium, and I drive up again in my 1950 Ford, and we're sitting in the car having a couple beers before we go into the concert, and some guy comes over and knocks on the window. He says, it was Dizzy. He says, hey, man, where's the closest liquor store? I says, it's one block down the street.
Wow.
So it was great stories. All these big bands, they're just, I saw the first big band I ever saw was the Canton band, and it just blew me away.
Oh yeah,
the goosebumps never went down.
Oh my goodness, he brought the orchestral concept into the big band, and it was just wonderful. And when I was teaching, I talked of the band boosters into having big bands as a fundraiser. They had a Clearanceville, Mitch Ellis, and they stopped doing it at Clearanceville, and so we started doing it, and we had Basie and Woody Herman and Kenton.
Wow.
And Maynard. We had Maynard twice.
Whoa,
so
fantastic.
I told the boosters, I said, let's get Maynard Ferguson. And they said, who's that? You know, and I said, well, if you walk down the street and talk to 100 people at random, 95 would say, never heard of him. 5 would say, Maynard? Is he coming? Maynard Ferguson?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we had Maynard and Buddy Rich.
Oh,
Buddy Rich,
man.
I talked to him before the concert. We're standing on the stage getting a sound check, and he said, now look, he said, who's running the sound? And I brought the guy. It was a teacher, but he did the sound of the auditorium. And Buddy Rich said, I'm going to do a drum solo, and I want the spotlight on my hands, not on my eyes. So don't bring the spotlight up. He said, let me make this really clear. I'm playing the solo, and the spotlight's on my hands. If it accidentally comes up to my eyes, the concert's over. We leave the stage and go.
That's Buddy Rich.
Yeah. And so I'm thinking, oh, my gosh. And I'm sure the sound man's thinking, oh, my gosh, with holding the spotlight. You
right.
know, don't bring it up. Don't bring it up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I played in a combo with a guy that played trombone with the Buddy Rich band.
Okay.
And he said Buddy Rich was unbelievably bad on bass players. He
oh,
said he would
gosh.
Go through about a bass player a week.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. So anyway, you've done all these arrangements. Why don't we listen to the Motown arrangement done by the Rochester Symphony
Wonderful.
Orchestra?
Wonderful.
Let's see what that sounds like.
Okay.
Thank you.
Wow, Craig, another great arrangement. And
thanks,
a terrific band, or orchestra, I should say.
Oh, gosh, they're one of the best. And yeah. I hadn't heard them before. My friend Keith and I went to hear the concert, and they're not a community group in the sense that they're volunteers. They're all paid, and they're some of the finest musicians in the Detroit area. The brass was just incredible. The whole group was wonderful.
Yeah. I got a good friend that plays trombone with that band, Dave Heipel. I don't know if you know Dave.
Sure,
but
yeah.
Dave plays trombone in the band.
Ron Kiszczak played with him.
Ron Kiszczak,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So we got some great players in the band. So anyway, in addition to all of this music stuff that you're doing, you're also doing some administrative stuff. You're doing this Michigan Jazz Festival.
Yeah. One of the founders, the great Johnny Trudell.
Johnny Trudell, right.
He passed away, and I was vice president at the time, and the board asked me if I would accept a president's role, and I did. And that's a wonderful group, and that's a wonderful festival. And in the last couple of years, I wouldn't say we had any time off with COVID, but we kind of reorganized our thinking. We added some new members to the board. We added an educational part to it. Some clinics, some outreach. We were determined that we needed to reach out to younger,
right,
more diverse people. So for the first time, we put the word out that you had to apply.
Mm-hmm.
The application process was simply the board deciding who should be in it.
Right.
But then this last year, we put the word out. You have to send in a video. You go on our website, and you see application process, and part of it is to send in video.
Right.
And so, pleasantly surprised, we got 135 applicants for about 35 spots.
Boy.
And so we had a committee that viewed every video, and we had in mind, if possible, of course quality would be first, but if possible, new people,
right,
younger people, mm-hmm, more diverse, more women, more African Americans. We
right.
just wanted to, for a long time it became kind of the same groups.
Exactly.
And so of the approximately 35 slots, we had 18 that had never performed in the festival before.
Really?
So, and a wider geographic area, and younger, and everything we hoped that it would be. And so this last year, you know, after being off, we didn't know, are people going to show up, what's going to happen, and we had one of the most successful festivals we've ever had.
Well, I was there, and I can tell you it was very, very successful.
Yeah, it was great.
And, you know, the thing I like about that festival is, first of all, the bands are all accessible, and they're all on stages very close together, mm-hmm, you know, within walking distance.
Seven different stages.
And
right.
they're all Detroit area musicians.
Right.
Musicians from Detroit, Toledo, maybe the west side of the state. And there are fantastic musicians in the Detroit area.
I think historically, Metro Detroit produced more terrific, wonderful jazz musicians than any other place. I mean, you go all the way back to the beginning of jazz, the list of people who came out of Cass Tech and out of this whole area, it's just amazing.
There's some phenomenal names that come from this area.
Yes.
And but we have today some fantastic players in Detroit.
Oh, absolutely.
And the thing I like about the festival is you go there and you can make a donation. Or you can go for free if you want to.
Free.
But it's
free parking.
But it's a festival that is accessible to everybody, and it's a one-day thing. You go and you can see all the groups you want to, and they're great groups.
Yeah.
Everyone is a great group.
Yeah.
And
like you see people walking down the hallway, and they have the program, and they're thinking, all right, I'm going to see about 20 minutes over here, but then I got to run over here. I want to catch this group. Yeah.
Because you got, what, four stages going?
Seven.
Seven?
Seven stages.
Well, that's right. I forgot about the one
one downstairs called the Rathskeller, and then the tent outside.
Right.
Yeah.
So seven stages running all day long.
Yes.
With terrific groups.
Absolutely. Yeah.
We've got a couple of videos from that one, too.
Oh, great. Okay.
So why don't we take a look and see what happens at the Detroit Jazz Festival?
Wonderful.
I've been all kinds of weather, as long as we're together. I love white and white and sweet. I love and everything. Love makes me treat you the way that I do. Gee, baby, baby, ain't I good to you? Gee, baby, baby, ain't I good to you? Gee, baby, ain't I good?
Wow. Again, more great music from the Detroit area and the Craig Strain band. Wow.
Thanks, George.
This is terrific. So let's talk about one other thing that you're involved with. And this just started about three or four years ago. And this is the MoBig Festival. It's not a festival. It's more like a series of band concerts.
Right. MoBig stands for Music on Belle Isle Group. And there's been a push to get the historic Remick band shell renovated from different groups for about 10 years. Way back, 50s, 60s, 70s, the Detroit Concert Band, Leonard Smith played there.
Right.
And they've even had the Detroit Symphony on there. And they have these wonderful concerts. And then around, I believe it was 1984, 85, groups stopped performing. The atmosphere at Belle Isle changed.
Yeah.
Became less of a picnic
family
thing, and a little bit rowdy. And then 4 or 5 years ago, the state asked the city if they could lease it for 30 years, and
right.
They would come in and clean it all up and change everything and make it more family friendly. There was some resistance to that because Detroit people thought, we don't want to give our control away,
right?
But DNR did win out and then immediately they cleaned it all up and started fixing things up, and that was about the same time that myself and other people were saying, we got to do something about the Remick band shell. And so we met and we formed this organization, became a 501c3 nonprofit, and we have two missions. One is the Remick band shell, and we want to bring that back up to performance level in terms of fixing. It's torn up, it's beat up. And so we started raising money and we started meeting with the DNR. And at first there was some polite head nodding, but we could tell they were kind of not really thinking we were serious.
Right.
Well, we raised $30,000 and we paid for the initial architectural assessment. And that kind of got their attention.
Yeah,
and they thought,
right.
Oh, these guys mean it.
They're serious.
And now they're working with us, and we're ready for the second step with that. But eventually, we will get that band shell renovated. The second half of what MoBig does, we were determined to bring live music back to the island, and even before the band show was going to be completed. And so we started a summer series called River Blast, exclamation point,
right.
2000 and whatever year it was. And first we did it over by the band shell. That wasn't working very well. Then we moved to Sunset Point, which is a beautiful area on the farthest west part of the island. You look out from there and you see the Renaissance Center
right.
in downtown Detroit.
Yeah.
And it's trees and picnic tables and barbecues and there's a place for people to use the bathrooms and there's an area that the bands can play on pointing right out at the audience. And that has worked really well. And so like this summer we had 10 groups. We started out with just doing concert bands.
Mm-hmm.
That was the idea of a concert band approach.
Right.
And then we kind of changed a little bit the last couple of years where we had a jazz group from Wayne State.
Okay.
We had my R&B band, Dr.
Right.
Pocket play. But we still had the Warren Concert Band, the Birmingham Concert Band, that type of thing too. So it was kind of a mixture this year. And we just had our last concert this last Wednesday, which was Birmingham. And the weather was perfect. It was a great night.
Yeah. Well, North Oakland Concert Band played the thing about 3 years ago we played it.
Okay, yes, I remember.
And I would like to do it again next summer if we could work that
Absolutely.
Out.
Absolutely.
It's a very good concert band, by the way.
Yes, yes.
One thing we haven't talked about is we talked a little bit about changing the groups. Before we do that, why don't we go and listen to one of the concerts at the Mobig, or the, what do you call it, the River?
River Blast.
River
and
Blast.
In the particular year, sponsored by Mobig on Sunset Point.
Let's listen to one of the concerts.
Excellent.
One of the groups that you lead, which I particularly like a lot, is the rock band that you have, Dr. Pocket. And this band blows me away. I mean, every time I hear these guys play, the lead vocalist is Bobby, is that his name?
Yeah, Bobby Guskovic. He plays guitar and sings. Yeah.
He is terrific.
Yeah, he's great. He's great to work with, too. He's a fun guy. And then, of course, Kim Lang is the female singer, equally
She's
good.
Great.
She got a wonderful voice.
Yeah.
Yeah, four horns, rhythm section.
Singers. And I assume you did all the arrangements for the for the four horns.
The whole band, rhythm section, horns,
right.
everything, vocal,
right.
yeah.
So that's exciting.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. It's great. Now, for many, many years, I was the trumpet player, and I had a little bit of a health situation. I'm still working on my trumpet chops, so I'm playing bass in that group now.
Yeah.
I want to still be part of it.
Of course.
So I've been a bass player for a long time, but I had to really get my bass chops up to play that stuff.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
challenging stuff.
Yeah, those are not easy parts.
And we do a Chicago tribute show periodically.
Right.
And so that's all Chicago, and we just happen to fit that genre really well.
Exactly.
And but we do other R&B stuff too.
Yeah. Why don't we listen to a little bit of Dr. Pocket?
Excellent.
That's a great band, like I say.
Excellent.
Hey!
gentlemen, that was Mr. Bobby G on the vocals.
Thanks. Welcome back. Wow, I love that band. Yeah, that's Chicago, baby. That is Chicago through and through. Tell us a little bit about the Dr. Pocket Band, how that got going.
Well, a fella asked me to be the music director or arranger of a similar band, and it wasn't going very well. And people were arguing, and we were having a rehearsal in my studio. I used to call it my basement, now I call it my studio.
Oh, yeah, good.
And it came to a head, and the drummer was the leader, and he got mad, and he had led us to believe we were going to be doing some big name things, and he just made it up. It wasn't true. So at one point, he had a handkerchief in his hand. He threw it down. He said, "All right, I'm leaving. Anybody who wants to stay with me, come on. Anybody who wants to stay with Craig, stay here." Nobody left. they all stayed, and he left. And so they said, "All right, we have the foundation here of a really good band. Mm-hmm. So Craig, take it over, and you do it." And so at first, I thought, what are we going to call it? And so I thought, we'll call it Brass Roots. Okay. I thought that would be a really cool name. So then I tried to register that name in Oakland County, and they said, "Well, there's already an organization called Brass Roots, but I think if you call them and get their permission, you can call yourself the Brass Roots Band." Okay. And so, all right. So I called, and the guy was real stern on the other side of the phone, and he said, "Well, my organization is not Brass Roots. It's called the Michigan Militia, but we have a Brass Roots Band play once a year when we protest at the state capitol." And he said, and "No, you can't use the name." And I thought, okay, no problem. And so then when I was in high school playing in the teen bands that we talked about, right. And then I went on to college, and some of my friends, Jack Rainwater and some of these other guys, yeah, they stayed performing. And so years later, I would run into some of them, and they would say, "How's the professor? How's the doctor?" You know, because yeah, I had right. the degrees, and it became kind of a nickname, at least from them. And then I thought, well, if I took doctor and put it together with pocket, because pocket means to play in a groove, to play right. in a pocket, exactly. a music term. So I called the band Dr. Pocket, and that's how fantastic. The name got started about 20-some years ago.
Wow, that's fantastic. And, that band's been together 20 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. It is great. I love that music.
It's a lot of fun. A lot of fun.
Craig, it's been such a pleasure to have you here.
Well, thank you, George. It's been great reminiscing and talking
about
all
these experiences of, you know, with music around the Detroit area for the last 30 years or so.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much.
Fantastic.
Thank you, George.
Thanks for coming.
Absolutely.